Well, in case you weren't here at the beginning of our service, welcome. It's good to have you here with us this morning at Grace Point. And those of you online, thank you again for joining with us. Just before we turn our thoughts to a study of God's Word, I want to, on behalf of all of us, thank Chris for leading us in worship this morning. Chris has been with us a number of times over the last number of years and is a talented and gifted servant of God. And we appreciate, Chris, you being with us this morning and leading us. This being the long weekend, and in addition to the fact that our worship director is on holidays this weekend, we thought we'd give the worship team a little break And so more of an a cappella kind of approach, a little bit different approach to worship, but it was wonderful to be able to hear your voices this morning in worship. So thank you again, Chris, for leading us this morning. Yes, let's do that. The video clip that we just watched is taken from the film Indiana Jones and the Last Crusade. Many of you would know that if you're old enough to remember that film. It's the third installment in the Indiana Jones action-adventure franchise. In the film that's largely set in 1938, Indy, played by Harrison Ford, searches for his father, played by Sean Connery, a professor of medieval literature who's been captured by the Nazis on a journey to find the Holy Grail. At a certain point in the attempted rescue, Indy's father is mortally shot, and at which point Indy decides he needs to risk his life to find the Grail and to use its healing powers to save his father. However, to get to the Grail, as we saw in the video, he had to pass three tests. First, he must become a penitent, humble man. Second, he must follow the word of God. And finally, he must take a step of faith. Having eventually passed the first two tests, with time running out, Indy faces the fear of the unknown and steps out in faith in order to cross an impossibly wide ravine using an invisible bridge on the opposite side of which lies the Grail. When I was thinking about video clips I could use to introduce our series of study this summer on faith, this was the one that popped into my mind. There's lots of ones that I could have used, and I know this is a bit of a dated one, but it is, I think, a good depiction of what we're going to be talking about over these summer months, Lord willing. This morning we launch our new summer study series called Heroes of Faith. And beginning today and for the 10 Sundays between today and the Labor Day long weekend in September, we're going to be giving thought to what it means as those in Christ to live our lives increasingly every day by faith. That is to live our lives in trust in God, to believe in God and His Word, and to live accordingly. Our focus in this endeavor is going to be Hebrews chapter 11, often described as the Bible's Hall of Fame, because in its verses we find recounted for us the actions of certain Bible characters who demonstrated a life of faith, who lived their lives in faith and in trust of God. I'll be sharing the teaching responsibilities this summer with Pastor Mark and also Steph Tedder. And together, our collective prayer is that through these studies, each of us will be encouraged to pursue increasingly a faith-based life, to walk by faith and not by sight, to ultimately be those whose lives as those in Christ are characterized by an approach to life that is based on faith and trust in God. And that's our prayer this summer, that as we go through this series together, that you will be encouraged, you will be equipped to better live your life as a Christ follower by faith. And so I want to encourage you as we go through these summer months, these summer weeks, that you be with us when you're in town, as you are here this morning. And if you're not able to be with us, maybe you're traveling, maybe you're on holidays, maybe some of you who are joined us online this morning are in that kind of situation, then please join us online so that you can continue to be part of what God is doing here through these studies this summer. This morning, what I want to do at the beginning of our time together is I want to have us talk about what is faith. I want to have us spend a few moments defining the nature of faith. Now, down through the ages, many have offered definitions of faith. For instance, the Protestant reformer Martin Luther wrote, "Faith is a living, daring confidence in God's grace." C.H. Dodd, renowned 20th century British New Testament scholar, defined faith this way: "Faith is that attitude in which, acknowledging our complete insufficiency for any of the high ends of life, we rely utterly on the sufficiency of God. Meanwhile, late Canadian theologian Clark Pinnock has written that faith is a resting of the heart in the sufficiency of the evidences. So then, what is faith? We're going to spend 10 sessions together through this summer talking about living by faith. We better begin with a definition of what faith is. Well, in our increasingly secular world, faith is often regarded at best as being a groundless optimism, and at worst, an ignorant, irrational, and dangerous fantasy. However, when properly understood, the faith that's to characterize our lives as those who are in Christ is a relational trust and confidence in God based upon rational evidence of His truthful reliability. This morning, as we begin, we're going to talk about faith as being confidence. And I'm going to use that word synonymously with faith. That faith is a confidence, and it is a confidence in God and in the truthfulness of His revealed word. Faith that we're to live our lives by is a confidence in the truth revealed by God in Jesus Christ as conveyed to us through the Scriptures, that is the Word of God. Now, of course, the reality is that every single human being lives to some degree by faith. Faith is an experience that is common to every one of us. It is impossible to go through a single day without living by faith in certain ways. For instance, when you came into the auditorium this morning and you found your seat and you sat in your seat, you exercised faith. You exercised a sense of confidence that the chair that you're sitting in would hold your weight. You placed your faith in the reality of that chair's supporting your weight. When you have surgery for one reason or another, you are placing your confidence at some level in the surgeon and the ability of the surgeon to attend to your medical need. Nobody is going to get on the operating table if they have no confidence, no faith, as it were, in the doctor and in the team that was going to actually proceed with the surgery. You are exercising a certain degree of faith. When you get into your friend's car and they're going to drive you to a certain location, you are exercising faith. You are exercising a certain level of trust and confidence in their ability to get you from point A to point B safely. If you knew that that person could not do that, you would not get in the car. You would lack faith and you would lack confidence in their ability to get you to your destination safely. So everyone has faith. But what makes the life of faith of those in Christ distinctive is not that we have faith, but rather in what our faith is placed. In other words, the focus of our faith. In other words, the basis of our faith. And for those of us in Christ, that is namely the trustworthy, unfailing nature of God. So ultimately, as those in Christ, our faith is to be placed and vested in the unfailing nature of the Lord God. You see, this summer study series is not about having faith in faith. There's a lot of talk about faith today that's basically have faith in faith. If you have some sort of faith, any sort of faith, then that is what it's all about. That's not what we're talking about this summer. And we're not talking about the power of positive thinking. Obviously, there is a certain ability and empowerment of thinking positively about one's circumstances, but that's not what we're talking about in this situation. We're not putting our faith in positive thinking. We're putting our faith in the unfailing nature of God Himself. That's what we're going to be talking about, Lord willing, over the next 2 months, having faith in a God who is absolutely trustworthy. As R. Kent Hughes has written, true faith is neither brainless or a sentimental feeling. It is a solid conviction resting on God's words. That's the faith that we're going to be talking about as we go through our series of studies through this summer. And what we're going to be doing is each week we're going to be walking through Hebrews 11, and we're going to be talking about the nature of this faith as it relates to the examples of faith that the writer to the Hebrews provides for us in this incredible chapter of Scripture. And so we begin our journey this morning. The writer to the Hebrew believers begins this famous chapter on faith by first explaining and illustrating two aspects of what such faith can do. So as he begins this chapter, he points to two aspects of the nature of this faith that he's speaking of. In Hebrews 11:1, he writes, "Now faith is confidence in what we hope for and assurance about what we do not see." Do you see these two parallel aspects that he's drawing out here in this opening verse of Hebrews 11? First, he says that faith is confidence in what we hope for, and secondly, that faith is an assurance about what we do not see. So let's talk about this for just a few moments. The original Greek word translated as confidence means a solid guarantee. It's wonderful to have a solid guarantee, isn't it? When you buy something, a solid guarantee means that if it breaks, you can take it back. In other words, within whatever the period it's warranty, if it breaks, if it fails to perform, you can take it back. And it's wonderful to deal with companies that have a solid guarantee. It's not so wonderful when you find out the guarantee is not worth the paper it's written on. But here we're talking about a solid guarantee. The nature of this faith is a solid guarantee. And notice the phrase, "what we hope for," refers to the future promised by God to those who are his own, that being an inheritance in heaven, the endless, overwhelming joy of living forevermore in God's presence. So as he begins, the first thing he talks about is that faith is confidence in what we hope for. Confidence, an unfailing guarantee in what we who are in Christ hope for, and that is ultimately to spend eternity in the presence of God in our heavenly home, in the new heavens and the new earth that God is going to create. That is our ultimate hope. And that's what he's speaking of as he begins. In the book of Revelation, we catch a glimpse of what life in heaven with Jesus is going to be like. In Revelation 7, we're told, "After this I looked, and there before me was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation, tribe, people, and language, standing before the throne and before the Lamb," which of course is the Lord Jesus Christ. "They were wearing white robes and were holding palm branches in their hands, and they cried out in a loud voice, 'Salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb.' All the angels were standing around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures, and they fell down on their faces before the throne and worshiped God, saying, 'Amen. Praise and glory and wisdom and thanks and honor and power and strength be to our God forever and ever. Amen.'" And then over in Revelation 22, we're told, "Then the angel showed me the river of the water of life, as clear as crystal, flowing from the throne of God and of the Lamb down the middle of the great street of the city. On each side of the river stood the tree of life, bearing 12 crops of fruit, yielding its fruit every month. And in the leaves of the tree are for the healing of the nations. No longer will there be any curse. The throne of God and of the Lamb will be in the city, and his servants will serve him. They will see his face, and his name will be on their foreheads. There will be no more night. They will not need the light of a lamp or the light of the sun, for the Lord God will give them light, and they will reign forever and ever." These are just two glimpses we have of the heavenly home of those who are in Christ. Now, you know, one day we're going to do a series on heaven. I think that would be a good summer series, maybe next summer, Lord willing. And we'll talk about heaven because there's a lot of nonsense about heaven that's out there. A lot of people writing books that they've gone to heaven and they've seen all sorts of crazy things. We should take a look at one day and what the scriptures teach about heaven. But one of the common things that often we feel or often I encounter with people who are in Christ is the idea that heaven's going to be boring. Oh, heaven's going to be boring. All we're going to do is going to worship God. It's going to be a nonstop, endless worship service. And I like worship, but I like other things as well. That's tragic to think that way. Do you think that God would redeem you and send his son to die for you to take you to an eternity of boredom? I don't think so. I don't think that makes sense, does it? It'll be the most life-giving, life-living experience you've ever had in your life. It will be life itself to the full. And so when we think of heaven, we need to think about a place where we want to be more than anything else. And you know why we want to be there more than anything else? Because Jesus is there. And we want to be in the presence of Jesus, and we want to live in the sphere of his love for all of eternity. Think back to some of the greatest moments in Toronto sports history. If you're old enough, you'll remember the excitement of Joe Carter's 1993 World Series winning home run, giving the Jays its second consecutive championship. I am old enough. I know that's hard for some of you to believe, but I am old enough. And the city went crazy, absolutely crazy. I can remember people out on their porches and backyards banging pots and pans, and it was just, you could step outside and the city was just erupting in a sense of joy and just overwhelmed by this victory. And who of us will ever forget Kawhi Leonard back in 2019? It seems a long time ago, doesn't it? Hitting perhaps one of the greatest buzzer-beater shots in postseason history to send the Raptors to the Eastern Conference Finals with a win over the 76ers. It seemed like the entire city, again, absolutely erupted together collectively in joy, celebrating this victory and, of course, the eventual championship that followed. I draw your attention to those experiences to suggest that perhaps these experiences just give us a little bit of a sense of what heaven is going to be like. A little bit of the sense of joy, overwhelming joy and peace, and a sense of tremendous exuberance and praise. You feel so alive in those moments, don't you? In those moments of victory, you're so alive. You're just overwhelmed by what's happening, and you're so joyful. I want you to think of heaven as being something like that, but so much greater because of the significance of what it is that we are celebrating and who it is that we are giving our praise to. So then the faith that is to distinguish our lives as those in Christ is, first of all, an unshakable confidence in the future promised by God in heaven. However, the defining faith of the Christian life is also an unshakable confidence in the unseen spiritual realities of God. And I want to spend a little bit more time on this second aspect of what the writer to the Hebrews begins this chapter on faith, speaking of the nature of faith and what it can do. Notice that our text in Hebrews 11:1 says that faith is, quote, assurance about what we do not see. The word translated from the original Greek, meaning translated as assurance in English, means an active certainty. It's a certainty. It's an active certainty. And what we do not see refers to spiritual realities that are absolutely real but invisible, such as the existence of God himself. So these are absolute certainties about things that we cannot see but are real. The NASA Hubble telescope was launched into low Earth orbit back in 1990. and it remains in operation to our day. Being outside the distortion of the atmosphere of Earth allows the telescope to capture extremely high-resolution images with substantially lower background light than ground-based telescopes. And consequently, the Hubble telescope has recorded for us some of the most detailed visible light images, allowing a deep view into space invisible to the naked eye. And there are a number of very famous pictures the Hubble telescope has captured that give us views into the depth of space that we have never, ever seen before. In a sense, faith is similar to the Hubble telescope, because it enables those in Christ to see spiritual realities revealed in the pages of the Bible that are invisible, but do in fact exist. Faith is kind of like that telescope, allowing us to see things that cannot be seen with the naked eye, to see things by faith and have a certainty about them. That's what the author to the Hebrews is talking about. Things that are either what we hope for or what we do not see. The writer to the Hebrews then goes on and says, this is what the ancients were commended for. In other words, the heroes of faith whose stories he's going to highlight as we go through this chapter, Hebrews 11, they are affirmed, as it were, by God. They are commended by God for having that kind of faith that he has just described in the first verse of Hebrews chapter 11. You see, God delights to find people who are confident in his word, because that kind of trust in him as being trustworthy is one that praises his name and exalts who he is. When you and I have confidence in the nature of God, that is an act of worship. That is saying that God is truthful, that God can be counted upon, that God is real. In fact, he is the ultimate reality. And when we live our lives daily by faith in that trust, despite the adversities that we face, that is an act of worship. Often we think of worship as being what we do on Sunday mornings when we come and worship in song, and that, of course, is an act of worship. But worship is far greater than that. It's far more expansive than that. It goes beyond singing songs. It goes to how we live our everyday lives. And one of the ways that we worship God Monday to Friday is when we live our lives by faith, trusting in him. Because that's an affirmation that he is trustworthy. He is who, in fact, he has said he is. Well, having explained the nature of Christian faith, in verse 3 of our text, the writer of Hebrews seeks to provide a first illustration of such faith. And before he jumps into certain characters that are whose stories are recorded for in the Bible that we'll see in the coming weeks, he points to creation itself. And this is very significant. And I want you to understand the significance of what he is doing. There in verse 3, he writes, by faith, he's just described that faith, by faith we understand that the universe was formed at God's command so that what is seen was not made out of what was visible. So this is where he starts. He doesn't start with Abraham, he doesn't start with Moses, he starts with creation and applies what he's just defined as faith to our understanding of creation. Now, the universe is an absolutely amazing place. Based upon the most recent astronomical data, the universe is thought to be some 93 billion light years wide. Now, I'm sure most of us don't even know what a light year is, but it sounds big, doesn't it? 93 billion light years wide. That's the best estimate now as to the expanse of our universe. Mathematicians estimate that there are at least 2 trillion galaxies averaging some 100 million stars each in the universe. This adds up to an incomprehensible 10 billion billion stars like that of our sun, with all of their planets and moons. Now think about that. It's hard to get your head around that, right? It's hard to even begin to grasp the expanse of the universe and just the overwhelming, staggering nature of the universe in which we live. And the opening verse of the Bible says this: in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Even though none of us were present to see it happen, as those in Christ, we believe this is true because we have an unshakable confidence in the teaching of God's word, including Genesis 1:1. However, this does not mean that our faith is a blind leap into the dark that must remain ignorant of the discoveries of science. For I would suggest to you an argument can be made that scientific observation has uncovered many realities that support the biblical revelation of God. In other words, just as hearing thunder logically points to the existence of lightning, even if we don't see the flash of lightning, there are various echoes of God in our universe, in our natural world experience, that point to his existence, even though we cannot see him. This is very important for us, I believe, as Christians to understand. Our faith is vested in who God is. And the ultimate revelation of God comes through Jesus Christ, and the record of that revelation comes to us in the Word of God. And so our final authority, our ultimate authority in life, is the Word of God. Please hear that. However, that does not mean that many of the things that we're learning about the natural world is something that we should be fearful of or something that somehow contradicts the revelation of Scripture. There are many, many observations of science that I would say support the revelation of the Scriptures themselves. Let me briefly suggest three such evidences for your consideration. Evidences that I would suggest that we find in the natural world that speak to the existence of a Creator God. First, there's our very existence. Scientists know of nothing in the universe that exists without a cause. Nothing. This is a principle that is constantly confirmed and never falsified. This is why, as Christian apologist Dr. William Lane Craig says, nobody, quote, nobody worries that while he's away at work, a horse might pop into being uncaused out of nothing in his living room and be there defiling the carpet. We don't worry about those kind of things because they never happen. They never happen. We therefore, I would suggest to you, have better reason to think that the universe did not just pop into existence, uncaused, out of nothing, than that it did. Logically, this suggests something or someone supernatural, outside of nature, above the natural world, as the first cause for everything that exists. A second natural evidence of the existence of a divine creator is our complex design. The universe is fine-tuned to support life on planet Earth. And there's so much could be said about this that I just don't have time to. But this cannot be overstated, that the universe is tuned in such a way that you and I can actually survive and live on this planet. As Christian philosopher Robin Collins has written, quote, over the past 30 years or so, scientists have discovered that just about everything about the basic structure of the universe is balanced on a razor's edge for life to exist. The coincidences are far too fantastic to attribute this to mere chance or to claim that it needs no explanation. The dials are set too precisely to have been a random accident. Colin continues saying, quote, I like to use the analogy of astronauts landing on Mars and finding an enclosed biosphere, sort of like the dome structure that was built in Arizona a few years ago. At the control panel, they find that all the dials for its environment are set just right for life. The oxygen ratio is perfect. The temperature is 70 degrees Fahrenheit. Humidity is 50%. There's a system for replenishing the air. There are systems for producing food, generating energy, and disposing of waste. Each dial has a huge range of possible settings, and you can see if you were to adjust one or more of them just a little bit, the environment would go out of whack and life would not be possible. What conclusion would you draw from that? You'd conclude that this biosphere was not there by accident. Volcanoes didn't erupt and spew out the right compounds that just happened to assemble themselves into the biosphere. Some intelligent being had intentionally and carefully designed and prepared it to support living creatures. And that's an analogy for our universe. The point is, my friends, that something of such complexity, designed for human life as our world in this universe, logically, I would suggests a divine designer. A third non-revelatory evidence of the existence of divine creator is our instinctive morality. Most of us naturally regard an atrocity such as the Holocaust as being morally wrong. We don't have to be told it's wrong. We know it's wrong. And it doesn't matter what Hitler believed or what the Nazis believed about it. We know it was wrong, and we're horrified by it. But why is that objective morality self-evident? Why do we intuitively know that some things are right and other things are wrong? Why are there moral truths that exist beyond anybody's own individual preferences, beliefs, or opinions? In other words, if morality is objectively real, what is the best explanation for it? That's a good question. And there's a lot of debate about that, a lot of thought given to that. Because all people have this sense of what is right and wrong, such a sense must have come from someone or something outside of ourselves. The moral argument for the existence of God argues that God is needed to provide a foundation for the existence of objective moral values and duties. The reason we as human beings have moral standards, in other words, is because God has made us that way. That God has made us as human beings with built-in sense of right and wrong. And isn't it interesting that in Romans chapter 2, the Apostle Paul speaks about that exact reality? In Romans 2, Paul writes, when Gentiles who do not have the law, here he's talking about people who do not have the revealed scriptures of the Old Testament, when Gentiles who do not have the law do by nature things required by the law, they are a law for themselves, even though they do not have the law. Listen now. They show that the requirements of the law are written on their hearts, their consciences also bearing witness, and their thoughts sometimes accusing them, and at other times even defending them. Therefore, the human moral sense points to the existence of God as our instinctive morality is an echo of the divine reality. Now, much more could be said about those three suggested evidences from the natural world for the existence of God. And there are many other evidences that we don't have time. If you're interested in learning more about this aspect of seeing God within the natural world, then please send me an email and I'll send you some additional resources that you may find helpful. But as we draw our study to a close this morning, I want you to notice the practical import of what the writer of Hebrews is doing in our text in Hebrews 11, verse 1 to 3. And you might miss this if we're not careful. You might fail to understand the practical application of what he's saying. The text says, "Now faith is confidence in what we hope for, and assurance about what we do not see. This is what the ancients were commended for. By faith, we understand that the universe was formed at God's command, so that what is seen was not made out of what was visible." Now, it's important for you to understand that the original audience to whom the writer is writing these words most likely were discouraged Jewish Christ followers, probably living in the ancient city of Rome, suffering opposition for their faith. In other words, the audience, the initial audience, the original audience to whom these words are written, are believers who are suffering for their faith. They are experiencing opposition for being those who claim the name of Christ and are seeking to live out that life in the midst of the persecution that is coming upon them. The author's intent is to encourage them. The whole book of Hebrews is ultimately designed to encourage these believers who are suffering for their faith, who are facing opposition. He's seeking to encourage them, and he's seeking them to encourage them to persevere despite the persecution that they are facing. These opening verses of chapter 11 are written with that purpose in mind. You see, the writer is showing his weary Hebrew readers that if they believe God created the universe out of nothing, even though they were not present to witness that reality, then guess what? They can also trust his promise of a new creation for his recreated people on a future day. So what he's saying here as he begins this chapter is this: if you live by faith, you have belief that God is the creator of the world in which we live. You were not there. You did not see that. But you have faith and trust in that because the Word of God teaches that. Likewise, even though you have not seen your heavenly home, you have not seen what God has prepared for you, you can have absolute, unshakable confidence in the reality of that future blessing. And because of that, that encourages you to persevere in the faith, in the face of the opposition. The reason this is true is because we actually live in the evidence for the power of God's word, that being that the universe didn't exist until God commanded it into its existence. You see, if God has promised to resurrect those who are his own into a new heaven and earth, then we can have unshakable confidence in that will in fact happen, because he's done that before. For in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. That's what he's saying to them. Don't give up. Persevere despite the opposition you're facing. Hold fast in your faith to God, because you are living in the reality of the evidence of God's faithfulness. Because God created this world, and you were not there to see it, but you believe it by faith because the Word of God says that, and the Word of God also promises those who are in Christ a heavenly home in the presence of the Lord Jesus Christ forever, in experiencing life to the full, and therefore you can have absolute unshakable confidence in that reality. So live in the face of your today in light of that tomorrow. Stand firm. Author Richard Gokin has said, "How can we shrink back from loyalty to Christ when every night sky and every rumble of thunder reminds us of his power to keep his promises?" God's word has promised us an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade, kept in heaven for you, even though for now we may have to suffer all kinds of trials. We can trust that promise, even if everyone in the office tells us it's nonsense, because by faith in his word, we know what God can do. Friends, that's why those of us in Christ should live by faith, confident that God will keep his promise of an eternity in his presence, and confident in his loving provision, even though we can't see him, because we live in an amazing universe that proves the power of God's word. Because God spoke this universe into existence. And God has promised, Jesus has promised, that one day he will come back and he will take us to be with him. And that he is gone before us to prepare a heavenly home for each one of us that are in him. We need to live our lives each day this week in the reality of that promise and the surety of that promise, despite any opposition, despite the troubles that we're facing in our lives. Let us focus on the promise, the unshakable promises of a completely trustworthy God. Heavenly Father, we thank you. We thank you for the opportunity we've had this morning to come together and to worship you. Lord, we thank you that as we have done so, we have had opportunity to lift up our voices in praise of you and to sing songs that exalt your name and give expression to the heart love that we have for you. We thank you that we've also had opportunity to join together in prayer and to come to you humbly, seeking your intervention, seeking your blessing and provision in our lives and in the lives of individuals who are part of this community and in the concerns of the world in which we live. And we thank you that as we've had these moments to turn our thoughts to your word, as we've launched this new summer series on heroes of faith, I pray, Lord, that you have spoken to us. I pray the Spirit of God will take the word that the word of God that we have considered together this morning, and that he will embed that within our hearts so that even today and the days of this week, that our lives would be a reflection of that reality, that we would seek to live in the confidence of who you are, and that your Spirit will give us the power to persevere in view of your promises. Thank you, Lord Jesus Christ, for what you have done for us. Thank you that despite the challenges that we face, that we know that you are with us, that you will provide for our needs, that you will give us everything that we need, and that, Lord, that you will enable us in you to meet the challenges of life. And we do thank you, as we've been reminded this morning, that our heavenly home is before us, that our best life awaits, and we thank you for that. We pray that we will look forward to that day with increased anticipation and an increased desire to be with you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, thank you so much for being here with us today. And as we close, a couple of quick announcements that you'll want to know about. First of all, if you have brought offering this morning on your way out at either the side aisles at the back, there are offering boxes, and you can place your offering there. Also, with regards to the barbecue, we have our first summer barbecue today. Pastor Mark and his small group are hosting. And so if you have pre-registered, you can pick up your tickets across in the gym. You can just go into the gym, get your ticket, pay for those tickets, and then head down out to the back patio. We do have a few extra tickets, so if you did not pre-register and you'd like to stay, then please go to the table as well, and we'll give you those tickets. We'd love to have you join us. If there are tickets that have been pre-registered for and they've not been picked up within the next 10 minutes, then those also will be available. And so hang around if you want to be part of our barbecue, and then just check in with Jingjing at the table, and we may be able to have you join us for lunch today. All right, so the last thing I'd say is those of you who are not joining us for lunch, then please join us over in the gym for our after-service refreshments. Great time to connect with one another. Lord, give you a good week and bless you.